that we had Tom Abbott's vision about
action. Thank you to the organizers for the invitation to speak. I'm happy to be here. Okay, so I'm going to talk about asymmetrical actions on hyperbolic spaces. So, like many of you, I'm interested in studying a group through its actions on pervasive actions by axonometry. But if you give me a group, it's going to admit many different actions on many different vector spaces, and they're not all going to be as useful for understanding the group. So what I'd like to do first is define a partial order on the set of asymmetric actions on metric spaces of a given group. So given a group G, and two actions by axonometries, metric spaces. So I'll say the action of G on metric space X and the action of G on metric space Y. We say that the action of G on Y dominates the action of G on X, which we write as this symbol. There exists a coarsely GF covariant coarsely Lipschitz map from Y to X, so from the bigger space to the smaller space. So what this partial ordering is supposed to be trying to capture is how much information about the group a particular action remembers. So higher up in the order are going to be actions that remember more of the group, so actions on Cayley graphs, for example. Way down in the partial order, at the very bottom, is going to be the action of a group on a point. Like that remembers no information, there's a Lipschitz map from any other space to a point. So I could just look at all of the actions of a given group under this partial ordering and see what we can say about that set. But the problem is that even if we look at actions that are very high up in this partial ordering, actions that remember a lot of information about the group, we still may not be able to understand those actions, either because the geometry of the space is very complicated, as is the case for a Cayley graph for a typical group, or possibly because the action itself is very complicated. So I'm going to add some additional restrictions here. So in terms of metric spaces, I'm going to be interested in groups that act on hyperbolic spaces, because I understand the geometry of a hyperbolic space. And in terms of actions, I'm going to require that the action of the group be what's called asymmetrical. So this is a generalization of a proper co-compact action. The action of a group G on a metric space X is called acylindrical if for all epsilon greater than or equal to zero, there exist constants r and n greater than or equal to zero, such that for every pair of points x and y in our space X, which are at least r apart, the number of elements in our group that move both x and y by at most epsilon is uniformly bounded by n. Okay, so take a minute to parse that definition, and I'll draw a picture for you. So in our space X, we're only going to be looking at points x and y that are far apart, so you should think of r as large. And think of epsilon as small. I'm going to draw the epsilon ball around x and the epsilon ball around y. So the action on x is asymmetrical if, for all but n elements of the group, if the image of x lies within the epsilon ball around x, then the image of y lies outside of the epsilon ball around y. For all but n elements, so uniformly finite and many elements quasi-stabilize both x and y. So this is a generalization of a proper co-compact action. For a proper action, you ignore the second point y, and we just say that this set of elements has to be finite. So a proper action is not necessarily asymmetrical because you might not have uniformly finite, but if you add the hypothesis that the proper action is also co-compact, then you get this council actions in a minute. But first, let me just define the post-set of actions that I'm interested in talking about today. So I'm going to define set AH of G for any group G to be the set of actions on metric spaces that are co-bounded and acylindrical with X a hyperbolic space. So I'm going to look at, for any given group, I'm going to look at all of its co-bounded acylindrical actions on hyperbolic spaces. And then this set comes equipped with this partial order. And so I'm just going to modify the equivalence induced by the partial order. And this is called the coset of acylindrically hyperbolic structures of G. Is to understand the group G by understanding the properties of this coset. So it's sort of like taking a step back, and rather than looking at one particular action at a time, I want to look at all of these actions together and the relationships between them and see what those relationships can tell me about the group G. So that's the basic idea here. You'll notice that I added co-bounded in there, which I think I mentioned before. We're looking at co-bounded actions mostly for technical reasons. A lot of study of acylindrical actions has been done in the context of co-bounded acylindrical actions on hyperbolic spaces. So that's where most of the tools that we're going to use were developed. So we're adding that in sort of for convenience. You can make the same definition without co-bounded, but not everything I would say is going to be true. Okay. So there are tons of questions you could ask about this coset. The first most basic question might be, how big is it? Right? Is this something that's just got one or two points? Is it large? So co-bounded means that the quotient of the space by the action of the group is the bounded element. So how big is AH of G for various groups? So this first result is joint work with Sahana Balasubramanian. And Dennis Gosen. And it says for any group G, one of the following occurs. Is that the size of this coset is 1. So there is a single co-bounded acylindrical action on a hyperbolic space. And in this particular case, that action is going to be the action on a point. So the action on a point is always acylindrical, because if you take a look at the definition over here, if x is a point, then if I choose any positive r, there are no two points that are distant at more than r apart. The definition is about easily satisfied. So this is sort of the trivial acylindrical action. Every group has that. The second possibility is that this coset could have size 2. Okay, so it could be two actions. In this case, the two actions are going to be the action on a point and the action on a quasi line. And this is going to happen if and only if the group is virtually cyclic. So if the group is virtually cyclic, then its Cayley graph is quasi-asymmetric to a line, and the group acts properly and goes compactly on its Cayley graph, so that can be a cylindrical action. It turns out that that's the only, these groups are the only ones that can have exactly these two actions. So these are the sort of uninteresting cases. And the third case is that the size of this coset is infinite. And in fact, It is not only uncountable, but it contains uncountable chains and uncountable antichains, so it's very large. That the group G is asymmetrically overdeveloped. So you can take this as a definition of an asymmetrically overdeveloped group. It's not the original definition. There are, I guess this would make five equivalent definitions of asymmetrically hyperbolic groups, but this is the one that's sort of most useful in this context. So asymmetrically hyperbolic groups admit infinitely many asymmetrical actions on hyperbolic spaces.
Is it commonly written to if there are two asymmetrically hyperbolic actions on two different spaces, according to your partial, is there a common drag which is finite?
That is larger than both of them?
Yeah.
That's an excellent question. We don't have a complete answer to that. I'll give a partial answer as part of this talk. So part of this talk is about finding largest elements in this coset, so ones that dominate everything. But in general, there's a lot that we don't know about this coset, and sometimes all of things can happen.
I'm sorry, look there. Mm-hmm. What does one mean? Does one mean so G is finite?
No, it just means that the only asymmetrical action on hyperbolic space that it admits is the action on a point. So for example, Z squared.
Okay.
Will be in that case.
Right.
So groups that split as non-trivial direct products, meaning both factors are infinite, are going to be in case one. Groups that have infinite centers, so solvable and nilpotent groups, those are all going to end up in case one. So they may have actions on hyperbolic spaces, but they don't have asymmetrical actions on hyperbolic spaces.
Is there a full characterization of that class? Where there's only one asymmetrical?
One?
Yeah.
Well, we say not asymmetrically hyperbolic and not virtually circular. But otherwise, no, not really. So there is, in the literature, there's a lot of properties of being asymmetrically hyperbolic. So if any of those properties aren't satisfied, they have one of the first two cases, but there's not a complete characterization. Okay, so is this case three that I'm interested in? So the case where this coset is interesting, where it's infinite. So let me give you some of the examples of the groups that fall into this case. So examples of asymmetrically hyperbolic groups. Okay, so first of all, we have non-elementary hyperbolic groups. So non-elementary here is that their Cayley graph is not bounded and is not a quasi one. So let's say you're not in case one and two. And these groups admit an asymmetrical action on the Cayley graph. So since proper cooking actions are asymmetrical, we can just use that. So the next example is non-elementary relatively hyperbolic groups. And these admit an asymmetrical action on their coned off Cayley graph. So remember, in this case, if we start with the Cayley graph of a relatively hyperbolic group, that's not necessarily a hyperbolic space. But inside of there, we've got subspaces corresponding to the cosets of the peripheral subgroups. So we've got some H, some coset of H, some H prime. And then if we cone off all of these subspaces, part of the definition of being a relatively hyperbolic group is that this space is hyperbolic. And actually, the action on this space is asymmetrical, and this is due to the eccentricity. Okay, so these will fall into case three. The third example are mapping class groups. And I should say non-exceptional mapping class groups, so a few small complexity cases are finite, and so they would fall into case one. But otherwise, mapping class groups are asymmetrically hyperbolic. And the acylindrical action on a hyperbolic space is the action on the curve graph. So the curve graph is the hyperbolic graph, and that's Dukakis and Minsky. And the fact that this action is acylindrical is due to Bowditch. And in this level of generality that I gave the definition of an acylindrical action, Bowditch actually defined an acylindrical action to deal exactly with this case. This was building on earlier work of Salah, who looked at acylindrical actions, in particular on trees. So mapping class groups are acylindrical. Acylindrically hyperbolic. Now, if you notice, I'm just giving you one acylindrical action for each, right? But since that one action that I'm giving you is not on a point and not on a line, you know that they can't fall into cases one and two. So this one action is enough to show that they're in fact implementing that.
Is the cardinality of the set the same for all of them?
Yes. So since these are co-bounded, you can actually think of these as so using a Milner-Schwartz argument, the co-bounded action on the space is the space is equivariant and quasi-isometric to a Cayley graph of the group with respect to an infinite generating set, is a subset of all subsets of the group that can be in the large one. Okay, so the next example are has zero groups with a rank one element. So these are elements that don't bound a half flat. These will all be acylindrically hyperbolic. And in the particular cases of right-angled Artin groups and right-angled Coxeter groups that have a rank one element, which is equivalent to saying that are non-directly decomposable, so don't split as a direct product, and not virtually cyclic. The acylindrical action of these groups is on the contact graph. So this result is due for right-angled Artin groups. It's due to Kim Roberta. And for right-angled Coxeter groups, it's due to Fairstein and Sisto. So I said way back at the beginning that there are at least five equivalent characterizations of the definition of an acylindrical hyperbolic group. They don't all involve actually finding an acylindrical action on a hyperbolic space. So in some cases, like the simple class of cat zero groups with rank one element, we don't know exactly what the acylindrical action is, which is why I stated it in a special case of running the kind of Artin groups and running the Coxeter groups. And then I'll just list some more without giving you the acylindrical actions. Many fundamental groups of three manifolds. So when I say many, there's a tripotomy for the fundamental groups of three manifolds. They're either virtually polycyclic, or they have a normal subgroup isomorphic to Z whose quotient is acylindrically hyperbolic, or they themselves are acylindrically hyperbolic. So we can say exactly which ones. Out of N, for N at least two, groups of deficiency at least two . These are groups that have at least two more generators than relators. The Cremona group. So these are birational equivalences of P2. Cremona group is acylindrically hyperbolic, and there are many others. So this is a really large class of groups. Okay. So it's this class of groups, these types of groups, that I'm interested in answering questions about this process. Or I'd like to know, in general, what does this poset look like for an acylindrically hyperbolic group? So there's lots of things that you can mean by that question. And what I want to talk about today is when this poset has a largest element.
The point,
and that's always smallest.
And that's always smallest. Yeah. There's never anything.
Like just one above with nothing else? I'm going to say probably not, but we haven't actually been Definitely not. Definitely not. So these, I'm going to say probably. There's these actions on a line you have to worry about. It's certainly true that there's no non-elementary action right above the action on the plane. Because if you start with the non-elementary action, I can always find I can kill the axis of velocidrome if I'm in that action, and then cone it off, and find something that's smaller that's still in the plane. But I don't want to say, not for these lineal actions that we kind of have to worry about. Yeah. Okay, so when does this have the largest element? Okay, so I guess first of all, sometimes it does, which is good. So the first result in this direction is joint work also with Sahanabala, Subramanian, and Benzosin. And it's in the case of relatively hyperbolic groups. So if G is hyperbolic relative to some collection of subgroups, H1 up to Hn, and for each I, AH of HI, so the acylindrical actions of the subgroups, have largest elements, then so does AH of G. So as long as the peripheral subgroups exhibit the behavior you want, your relatively hyperbolic group will exhibit that behavior as well. So let me give you just an idea of the proof. The proof is constructive. So we build a hyperbolic space on which G acts asymmetrically and show that it has to be largest. So I'm going to do this without this fit, assuming G is hyperbolic relative to just one subgroup, so I can drop those subscripts. So I've got this peripheral subgroup H. I know that it has a largest asymmetrical action on the hyperbolic space. So let's say that that is H of S. Let's say that this is largest in AH of H. So here's my S. And I'm going to fix just some base point, and then I'll fix the orbit of that base point, HS. OK, so that's what I'm given. And then to build a space on which G acts, I'm going to start just with the caligraph of G. So here's the caligraph of G, and just like when we form the cone dot caligraph, we've got H and cosets of H. Subspaces correspond to H cosets sitting inside of that. Now, to perform this acylindrical action, we just cone dot those subspaces. We, in general, don't want to do that. Because if we do, if this H admitted a non-elementary acylindrical action on a hyperbolic space, then we've sort of lost that information by collapsing it. Right? This is going to be too small to be able to speak, because sort of H could have done more. So what we want to do is say that since this space is the best that we can do for H, we're just going to glue that on to this caligraph. So I'm going to glue disjoint copies of S, one for each coset of H, onto the caligraph, and I'm going to do it so that in my trivial coset, just H, the base point is going to be glued to 1, and then I'm going to glue the orbit H equivariantly, so HS is glued to the point H, and then I'm going to translate the whole thing using the transversal. I'm going to glue this on, this new space is going to be called R. So the claim is that this space R is actually hyperbolic, the group acts acylindrically on it, and in fact it is largest. So all of these things take some checking, but the key point is that this is actually a relatively hyperbolic group. So these cosets are geometrically separated, meaning they don't interact with each other. They have bounded diameter intersection, neighborhoods of them have bounded diameter intersection, which means that we can actually do this. We can glue different copies of S onto different cosets of H without messing up the action. You can imagine that if they intersected a lot, you wouldn't know how the group G should act. You have, if there was a point connected to both of these S's, then you'd have competing definitions for how the group should act. But because this is relatively hyperbolic, that doesn't happen. This space is actually, as a metric space, hyperbolic relative to the pieces that are the caligraph at H with S being on it. And this space S is itself hyperbolic, so it's as a metric space, it's hyperbolic relative to hyperbolic pieces, uniformly hyperbolic pieces. And so is, in fact, hyperbolic. And for largest, this is very hand-wavy, but outside of the cosets, it just looks like the k-graph. The k-graph is as big as you can get. You kind of can't blow that up at all. Inside the cosets, you've blown it up as much as possible because you've moved in the largest action for h. You really can't do any better.
So I presume the log groups which satisfy the conditions of this, they're not asymmetrically hyperbolic groups which do have largest elements.
Non-asymmetrically hyperbolic groups that have largest actions?
Well, I presume there are
hyperbolic
groups relative to asymmetrical hyperbolic groups that have largest elements. Those things do exist.
Yes, they do exist. And I'm going to give you some examples of non-relatively hyperbolic groups with largest elements in a minute so that they can be these HIs. And you can take, for example, free products of them. And then you get ones that satisfy this condition. So that's...
So is this typical, do you think?
That...
This situation?
Where if you have subgroups that have largest actions, yeah, then you can do this? No. I think it's not typical. This construction, there are very special cases where you can extend actions from subgroups to groups, but the subgroups have to be very nice. So one case where you can do it is hyperbolically embedded subgroups, which are an analog of peripheral subgroups, but for asymmetrically hyperbolic groups. You can always extend the actions, but even in that case, if you take a largest action of a hyperbolically embedded subgroup, it's not going to extend to the largest action of the group necessarily. So there's sort of two problems. One is actually building this extension, if it kind of makes sense, and the other is ensuring that it's still largest. If G is a right-angled Artin group or right-angled Coxeter group, then AH of G has the largest element. Notice that when I wrote down right-angled Artin groups and right-angled Coxeter groups as examples of asymmetrical hyperbolic groups, I qualified it. I said non-directly decomposable and non-virtually cyclic, and I'm not doing that in this theorem, and that's simply because if you're in case 1 or 2 of this main theorem here, then you do have a largest action. In case 1 is the action on the point, in case 2 is the action on the line. So the only context where this theorem is interesting is when we qualify right-angled Artin, right-angled Coxeter groups as I did over there, but it is true in general. Okay. So this proof is also constructive. So we build a hyperbolic space on which a right-angled Artin group or right-angled Coxeter group acts, and we show that it's largest and asymmetrical. So here's what we're going to start with. So it doesn't mean nothing I say right now is going to matter if I'm talking about a right-angled Artin group or a right-angled Coxeter group, so I won't specify. We know that this group admits an asymmetrical action on the contact graph. So the contact graph, I'm going to give a definition of this that is probably not, but it's definitely not the typical definition, but it's equivariantly quasi-asymmetric, and it's more useful for these purposes. So the contact graph is formed from the Cayley graph of the group, which in this case is the one skeleton of the Coxeter group complex on which it acts, by coning off the hyperplane stabilizers. Which I'm going to call HI. So what we're assuming that we're starting with a finite defined graph. Right? So then there's going to be finitely many orbits of hyperplanes and the Q complex. And this contact graph, I start with the Cayley graph. And inside the Healy graph, for each hyperplane stabilizer subgroup, there's a subspace corresponding to it, and then all of their cosets. So I've got HI, HJ, THI, where a few of these are the hyperplane stabilizers, and I just count them off. And this space is the contact graph. So the typical definition is that it's a graph whose vertices are hyperplanes, and there's an edge between two hyperplanes if they contact and they intersect or oscillate. But this is a variantly quasi-symmetric. And notice that every picture I draw is the same, which is why I prefer this. Okay, so how do we build a new space for these red and Martin groups or red and composite groups? So we're going to start with the Cayley graph. So here's my Cayley graph viewed from above. And inside, I've got these hyperplane stabilizers and their cosets. Now, okay, so if I cone them all off, I get the contact graph. And maybe that's fine, maybe that's largest, but it's possible that it's not. And the way that it might not be largest is if one of these subgroups emits some asymmetrical action on the hyperbolic space. And then by coning it off, you would have lost that information. It would have moved down in the coset for the entire group. So the first thing I'm going to do is if some HI is not acylindrically hyperbolic and not virtually cyclic, I'm going to cone it off. So these two conditions on the hyperplane stabilizer mean that we're in case one. It was a single asymmetrical action on a hyperbolic space, and it's the action on the point. So you can think of this as coning it off as like gluing the only asymmetrical action that this subgroup emits into this Cayley graph. So this one gets coned off, and I'll come off its conjugates as well. So that's certainly not going to have you move down in the coset. Now, what about HI? Well, when we were doing this for relatively hyperbolic groups, we had this nice largest action of the subgroup on a hyperbolic space just waiting for us to glue in. And we don't have that here, right? We don't know what HI acts on. But we do know that it's a hyperplane stabilizer in a right-angled Artin group or a right-angled Coxeter group, which means it itself is a sub-right-angled Artin group or right-angled Coxeter group. So in fact, it acts on a contact graph, or it acts on, I guess, let's say properly co-compactly on a Coxeter cube complex, right? So we can look at the hyperplane stabilizers of the action of HI and repeat. So we'll repeat this step for hyperplane stabilizers of HI.
Are you arguing by induction, or are you just doing it all in one go?
It's going to be by induction, I guess. Yeah.
Because it is itself a nice right angle part.
Yes, that's right. So HI is itself a nice right-angled Artin and Coxeter group. And not only that, but the defining graph is going to be smaller than the original defining graph. We're going to be starting with something finite, so this process will stop. So we're going to look at these hyperplane stabilizers for HI acting on the sub-Cat0 cube complex. And then do the same thing. We'll cone them off if their only actions are on the point. Otherwise, we won't. And then we just keep going, smaller and smaller. And we have to stop at something. And when we stop, so the process must terminate, when we stop, either at the smallest level, what we've done is cone off all of the hyperplane stabilizers, in which case what we have sitting in here is a copy of the contact graph for that subgroup, right? Which is hyperbolic and which that subgroup acts asymmetrically, or we've coned we've got something that's not coned off, in which case it has to be hyperbolic itself. Okay? So at either level, we are we have a acylindrical action on a hyperbolic space, and then we're sort of sticking them together larger and larger. And the work sort of comes in and showing that these pieces all fit together nicely.
So, I mean, so your construction, could you state it as if HI is hyperbolic, stop. And if it's not acylindrical, just like coned off. Otherwise,
Yes, you can. That's right. So you can just think of it all in terms of hyperbolicity. There's a couple reasons that we didn't do that. So one, well, let me say why and then let me say one thing first. So first of all, notice, I mean, the question is, what is this space in the end? Right? So I've started from the top and I've kind of worked my way down to get something. If you just started with the calligraph and you wanted to do it all in one go, what this is the calligraph of the space, is the calligraph of G with all non-trivial product regions coded off. So for each of these hyperplane stabilizers, either it splits as a non-trivial product, meaning both factors are infinite, or it's based on the definitive law of the virtual circuit, in which case we repeat the process. So the only thing that we end up coding off in the end are product regions. And hearing me talk about product regions should remind all of you about Alex's talk earlier today about hierarchically hyperbolic spaces. And in fact, the theorem that we prove is a little bit more general. So I've described it for right-angled Artin groups and right-angled Coxeter groups, partially because I didn't know that Alex was going to define a hierarchically hyperbolic space earlier. But this theorem is true for all hierarchically hyperbolic groups. So these are hierarchically hyperbolic spaces where that first space X that you start with is in fact a calligraph of a group. So this holds in a lot more generality. And this is part of the reason that we don't just say it is hyperbolic, turn it off, otherwise don't. Our process is a little bit more involved because we do the proof in a much more general context. But it is true here that we could do this. So Alex listed lots of examples of hierarchically hyperbolic spaces. Many of them were groups. But the examples that this applies to are so hyperbolic groups, in which case this gives the action on the calligraph. Mapping processes, which you can, in this process, gives the action on the curve graph. So the largest action for the mapping class group is, in fact, the action on the curve graph. And if you do this for right-angled Artin groups, which I just did, in fact, what you get back is the contact graph. So in a right-angled Artin group, every hyperplane stabilizer is going to split as a non-trivial direct product. So they're all going to get combed off. They're all flats. So this is the contact graph. But what's interesting is that for right-angled Coxeter groups, this is not the contact graph. So for right-angled Coxeter groups, it is possible to have a hyperplane stabilizer, which is asymmetrically hyperbolic itself. It's not just a flat. And then, I mean, saying, I'm putting not the contact graph in quotes because we can't say what it is other than this space that we construct. It's not a familiar space. And then the last example that this theorem applies to is fundamental groups of three manifolds. And these are ones with no nil or sol in their quantum decomposition. And these have a largest action on a blow-up of the JSJ tree associated to the JSJ decomposition. So the JSJ tree, just like the contact graph. So it's a graph, but it's equivariantly quasi-symmetric to a cone-off of the Cayley graph of the three manifolds. This is a Miller-Schwarz argument, if you see that. And the coned-off pieces are the stabilizers of the vertices in the JSJ tree. So those are the fundamental groups of the hyperbolic pieces or the cipher-Clyburn pieces. The cipher-Clyburn pieces stay coned-off. They're like this first, they're not asymmetric hyperbolic and not virtually cyclic. But the hyperbolic pieces are hyperbolic, so we don't cone them off at all. Right? So that's the part that gets blown up. So the vertices corresponding to hyperbolic pieces are blown up and replaced with the calligraph of that hyperbolic group, and the rest is the same. Okay. So Things are looking pretty good. This is a lot of groups that whose postdocs have largest actions. So you could ask whether all finitely generated groups have postdocs that emit largest elements. And in fact, the answer is unfortunately no. So the first result in this direction is joint work with David Hume. If G is a infinitely presented C prime 1/14 small cancellation group, with, and now I'm going to give you two technical conditions that I'm not going to explain because there isn't time. But with sufficiently many pieces, that is uniformly power-free, then AH of G does not have a largest element. So these two technical conditions are really not that restrictive. So you should just think infinitely presented C prime 1/14 groups. Infinitely presented is important because if these groups were finitely presented, then they'd be hyperbolic. So this is infinitely many relations. So, so what happens here for a C prime 1/14 group? Well, so let's say that this group has some presentation. Yeah.
So,
if it's finitely presented and small cancellation, then it's hyperbolic.
Is AHG going to have a large element?
It's going to be the action on the KU after group for a hyperbolic group. So in this partial ordering, the KU map is going to be on the top.
I'm not assuming any hyperbolicity or large hyperbolicity. Suppose it's just finitely presented.
Oh, a finitely presented group, yes. Not small cancellation.
Yes.
Sorry. It's not true. So the next example, I'm going to give you a reason. Yeah. Okay. So if we have this, let's say that this is a small cancellation presentation of the groups. So we've got infinitely many relators here. The way to think about this, or the way that I think about this at least, is that this group can be represented with infinitely many cycles. So these are cycles ci. Infinitely presented, one for each relation. And these have labels ri, which are in the relations. And then these cycles are just going to embed in the KV graph. So, in the KV graph, the way you get loops is by relations. Right, so all I'm doing is separating those loops out so I can think of them one by one rather than thinking about how they fit together inside of the data. Okay, so first of all, Gruber and Sisto showed that this type of group, such G, act acylindrically on what David and I call the complete cone. So what this complete cone is, well, you start with a KV graph group that has all of these embedded cycles, and then you just change what you embed in place of the cycles. So you glue in complete graphs on CI to the KV graph of the group. So these cycles are sitting inside there, you essentially just cone them off. Right? You have edges between every pair of relations. And they show that this is a hyperbolic space. on which the group acts asymmetrically. So these groups are, in fact, asymmetrically involved. And they show this in more generality than just the statement of this theorem. They show it for C prime 1/6 graphical small cancellation groups with some technical conditions as well. But this is one asymmetrical action on the hyperbolic space that these groups are involved. So the idea behind showing that there isn't a largest action is to find more actions. So what David and I do is build many different asymmetrical actions of these groups on hyperbolic spaces, sort of model them, their construction, and show that we can find two incompatible ones, two sufficiently different ones. So the idea is build many asymmetrical actions on hyperbolic spaces and find two very different ones. Okay, so here's how we build the actions. We've got these cycles, and just like Gruber and Sisto do, we're going to change the cycles. We're going to add edges to the cycles. So we're going to add edges to each CI to form a delta hyperbolic space, which we're going to call CI hat. So by that we mean that not embedded in the heliograph, just the cycle itself with added edges is hyperbolic. And here the important part is that delta is independent of phi. And then we just take our new graph, CI hat, our combed off cycles, and we move them into the heliograph instead of the original cycles. Right, so maybe isn't a complete cone, they could still have, you know, some diameter, but we need them to be hyperbolic. Call this new space X hat. So it's just a cone off of the heliograph formed by adding edges. So it turns out that if you do this, all you have to do is make these cycles hyperbolic, uniformly hyperbolic, you're going to end up with the hyperbolic cone off of the heliograph. You're going to end up with a hyperbolic space. And in fact, these technical conditions we added are going to ensure that the action on that space is in fact asymmetrical. So X hat is hyperbolic, and the action is asymmetrical. Now, this should not be obvious. This is complicated. This takes a lot of combinatorics and looking at the small cancellation conditions and figuring out what triangles look like and what quadrilaterals look like in this space. But it is true that we end up with asymmetrical actions on hyperbolic spaces as long as we just glue in uniformly hyperbolic cycles. Okay, so here are the two very different actions. So two actions. So for each CI, I'm going to fix two different sets of base points, X sub I and Y sub I, and I'm going to fix them a quarter of the way around the cycle image. So here's my point xi, here's my point yi, so that the distance between xi and yi is half the diameter of the cycle. And then I'm going to form two different hyperbolic graphs from this cycle, and I'm going to do this for each I. So one...
ci hat, you're going to quasi-asymmetric creep.
Sorry?
On the ci hats, the things that you're doing, are those uniformly geometric trees?
Not, they don't have to be. You could do that, but it'll work without that. So the first one is going to be one where I use the base point x, so I'm going to call it ci hat, and this is x. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add an edge between any two points in this cycle that are the same distance from xi. So everything that's distance 1 from xi will get joined, the points that are distance 2 from xi will get joined, and it's going to end up looking this. Or yi is sitting somewhere over on the side. And this is one hyperbola. Because these are single edges. But I'm going to do the same thing for this point yi. So I'm going to get my ci hat, parentheses y. And this is going to look long and thin, but it'll be long and thin in the other direction. So I'll glue an edge between any two points that are the same distance from yi in that side. And xi is sitting somewhere over there. I do this for every I, and then I glue all of these new one hyperbolic graphs into the Cayley graph. So I get two different spaces on which this group acts. So here, I get some x hat corresponding to the base points x, and here, I get some x hat corresponding to the base points y. And the claim is that these two are sufficiently different. And if you kind of think about this, so in this, so I said this was an idea. There's a lot of details that I'm sweeping under the rug here in the construction and how this works, but the basic idea is that if you have a single action that dominates both of these actions, well, dominates means that there's Lipschitz maps, equivariant Lipschitz maps. So because this action dominates the x hat x, these distances along the side here have to stay long because they're long here. But because it dominates this one, the x hat y, these distances have to stay long. And those two distances are sort of competing in this cycle. One is distances along this side that have to stay long, and the other is distances along that side that have to stay long. And if both of these distances stay long for every cycle, then essentially you need the cycle in there. But if these cycles are all in there for every I, then it's not hyperbolic. I guess it's infinitely presented, these cycles are getting bigger and bigger. So these two actions are sufficiently different to show that there is no largest action in this case. Okay, and then let me just say, because I was asked about a finitely presented example, there is a finitely presented example. The reason that it doesn't have a largest action is a little less intuitive, but it is the Brady's example of a non-hyperbolic normal subgroup of a hyperbolic group. So it's finitely presented, normal with quotient z, and torsion free. So it's a pretty nice group. And it, in fact, does not have a largest action either. So the line between having a largest action and not is not simply finitely presented, but it might be some higher finiteness property, perhaps. But we don't know that. And maybe the last thing I'll say is that I focused on the question of the largest action. There are so many questions that you could ask about this coset that we don't know the answer to. And the long-term goal of this is that this coset should somehow, we would like to be able to topologize it and somehow make it a modulized space of asymmetrical actions. So an analog to modulized space, type Euler space, outer space, kind of along those lines. We don't know exactly what to expect, but we do know that if you have an asymmetrical hyperbolic group, the outer automorphism group of the group acts on this coset. So we already have a nice action, but we just don't understand it well enough to even think about putting a topology on it or anything like that yet. So that's the future. Thank you.
Okay, any questions for Hannah?
Yeah.
So the edges that you had for different CIs like interact with each other.
They're not going to interact with each other. They'll be labeled by. They're not.
Yeah. Okay. I mean that. Right. I guess what I mean is that they affect the geometry of what you see in that x hat.
Yes. So, which are the details that I'm sweeping under.
Right. Yeah.
Yes. So there are certainly details there, and in fact, so I mean, I lied. The two actions in fact aren't enough. You need to do rather than just choosing two of them. You need to choose infinitely many to show that one action doesn't dominate all infinitely many of those. It's sort of the core of the reason that you said. But there's a lot more work here than just looking at the pictures and saying that it works.
But is that also the reason why you need like 1/14, something less than 1/6 to make sure that?
So the 1/14 actually, it's possible that we could get it to be 1/6, but we use it to prove that these spaces are hyperbolic. So we look at bygones in our space, and then we define comparison bygones in the Cayley graph. And then we need to look at how far the sides of the comparison bygones in the Cayley graph travel from each other. And to get the right contradictions to show that something's hyperbolic, we just made it a slightly smaller constant. Yeah, I know. We make the same face, but this is kind of where the numbers worked out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So undefined does not appear on the list.
It does not. It does not. So the thing about added n is that we don't know, so we've got all these hyperbolic complexes on which it acts, but we don't know if any of those actions are acylindrical. So we know that, for example, the action on the free splitting complex is not. We know that the action on the free factor complex is a WBD action. We don't know if it's uniformly WBD or if it's acylindrical. So we sort of, in some sense, we don't have a starting place for added n. It's possible that if the action on the free factor complex is acylindrical, then that will be largest. I don't know that that's necessarily true. It could be the action on the cyclic splitting complex, if that happens to be acylindrical, or there are all these complexes in between. Right? So there's lots of different possibilities, and we just don't know enough yet to be able to, to sort of confidently say it's wide open. Yeah.
Any more questions? Mm-hmm.
I think
it's Grady's example of a finitely presented normal non-hyperbolic subgroup of a hyperbolic group. It's finitely presented in torsion free.
Okay, well that's that.